This, right here, is how you paint an eye in oil paint. Today we are going to be working on an oil primed linen. Now linen canvas is a little bit nicer than cotton canvas. It has a smoother surface. So if you can find linen canvas, I would recommend getting it. You can paint much more smoothly and with a little bit more finesse. I then toned that linen with raw umber paint thinned with mineral spirits. After that was dry, I could begin the first stages, which was blocking in my eye with raw umber paint and a small round brush. When I draw something out like this, I often will dilute the paint so that it goes on kind of like watercolor, and then that way I can mask in the shadows and really use the relationship between light and dark shapes to get the proportions down. When I start drawing an eye, I really like to look at things as shapes and angles and tilts. So I'll often look at that shape of the white of the eye, the sclera, on either side of the iris to help me begin placing those initial tilts. And then I come in on those sides as if it is a tilt and has an angle relationship to the shadow shapes around and the eyelid. And that way I can place it very objectively as a shape and not as a conceptual eye just yet. And that helps me really get the proportions correct. It helps me get those relationships and those placements as accurate as possible. And once those shapes coalesce, I can then draw a little bit more conceptually and think about things as being curves, place that pupil, really shape that iris in a more structural way. And after all that's in, I can take some titanium white, mix that with my raw umber, and paint a grisaille or monochromatic underpainting, which will give more body to my paint later on. After I've masked it in and blocked it in with the raw umber and the white, I let it completely dry overnight so it's dry to the touch. Then I can begin my form pass. Now the colors I'm gonna use here are titanium white, Naples yellow, yellow ochre, pale rose blush, cadmium orange, alizarin crimson, raw umber, and ivory black. Now the first part of the eye I tend to start on is the brow above that upper eyelid. Now this is because I typically am painting full portraits, not just eyes floating around in space. And when I do that, I want to prioritize the structure that the eye sits in. That way it feels integrated into the face and relates to the nearby structures. So that upper brow form is a very prominent form that really helps you imagine the full eye socket. It's really where I tend to start and will lock you into that structure. The main thing I think about is the direction of the light coming in, where it's striking that form most directly, and what the color of that form would be under that direct light. Once I identify that and mix out my starting color, I then sculpt around, trying to put myself in three-dimensional space and really pretend like I'm making this real three-dimensional sculpture inside the virtual world of my canvas. It's really that sense of making something that's real and three-dimensional that guides my brush and helps me craft gradations that look realistic. I'm mixing in some raw umber with my pale rose blush, cat orange, and alizarin so that I can keep it a flesh color, but also lower the value and lower the chroma or neutralize it so that it looks like that form is turning from the light into the shadow. And I spend a lot of time blending, wiping my brush clean on a paper towel so I can come back in and finesse a smooth gradation, because my main objective here is to make this look 3D, make it look round, and give it a tactile, sculptural feeling. Once that coalesces, I can grab more alizarin crimson, a little touch of cadmium orange, and I can really bring up the chroma near that shadow edge, and that makes it look like the light is transmitting through the translucent flesh and bringing that chroma up. Now I work in a very sequential way, so the next form I do is the upper eyelid because that tucks up under that brow form. And very similar to the brow, my first task, my first goal is to make that eyelid look round and three-dimensional. Now the light comes in at the same direction as it did from the brow just above. They're very close together. And so I start on that light-facing part of that eyelid and simply make it look round. The only difference is that it doesn't fully turn into shadow until you get to that underplane. So when I move left to right or right to left on that, I have to keep the values very compressed or narrow and similar so that I don't overmodel it and make it look too dark and heavy. The next forms are the white of the eye, the sclera, and then the iris. Now, the neat thing about those two forms is that they kind of have this sort of strange relationship where the white of the eye, the sclera, the main eyeball, is this convex full form. So it gradates sort of as you would expect. It gets a little darker as it rolls away from the light source. It also darkens as it tucks up under that eyelid. But the iris is more of a bowl-like form. It kind of comes in a little bit more concavely. So towards the bottom, where it rolls out back towards the light, is where it gets lighter. As it rolls up, it gets darker and, like the eyeball, tucks up under that eyelid, getting some of that cast shadow. That kind of compounds the darkness there so that the iris is darker as it goes up when light is coming from above. And of course you have the pupil in there, that darkens things down. So you have this nice dark value at the top of that iris, and then it comes down again like a bowl, and you get some of that local color of the iris. But one thing to keep in mind is the outer perimeter of that iris usually stays relatively dark, so I'm using raw umber and ivory black to craft that consistent curvature around the ellipse of the iris. And I'll go back in and I'll reinforce and find that pupil, which very often I paint with ivory black, and I keep it very clear and crisp and try to center it in the middle of that iris. And I spend a lot of time going back and finessing and finding crisp little edges where that eyelid makes contact with the eyeball and how that overlaps and intertwines with the tear duct. And right where that eyeball meets the tear duct and the eyelid comes on top of them, there's usually a little alizarin crimson raw umber nook where it casts a shadow that warps over those forms. And that really makes it seem structural and like it's attaching to the head. The last main form we need to focus on when we paint the eye is the lower eyelid. Now, I think of it in two parts. You have the top shelf of that lower eyelid and you have that front plane. Now, the top shelf is typically more light facing because usually in portraits, we have light coming from above. Now, the further to the outside of the eye you get, the sharper that difference is between that top plane and the front plane. The closer you get to the tear duct, the more rounded that gets. So that interplay between sort of a soft rounded edge near the tear duct and the more planar edge as you move to the outside corner of the eye is really what goes into making an eye look naturalistic and realistic. The other thing you want to think about is that on that lower eyelid, the front plane is sort of translucent. Light is passing through it. So you get that redder hue and you get that more chromatic saturated color that makes it look more like flesh, translucent flesh. And that flavor of life and naturalism. And you really want to go for those chromatic moments because it gives it that little touch of life and realism. One of my favorite forms, and it's one of the most overlooked forms when painting the eye, is this inner tube-like form, this sort of donut-shaped form that wraps around the tear duct. I spend a lot of time on it. I try to treat it with as much respect as you would if you were painting the eyelid or the iris, and I try to make it look very round and three-dimensional. Then when these forms coalesce, I can go back in and put some of those secondary highlights that make the eyeball look wet. So right there, right where the eyeball and the lower eyelid meets, there's a little bit of moisture that usually catches sort of a horizontal crisp highlight. And then you get to that edge there, the radius of turn between the top plane of the lower eyelid and the front plane, and you get that little highlight broken up a little bit. And that way, by breaking it up, you can convey those lower eyelashes coming out from the lower eyelid without actually painting little strands of hair. I always err on the side of being very, very subtle with eyelashes, even those eyelashes on the upper eyelid. And I'll usually kind of bring my arm in and I won't touch down, and then I'll try to make a deft stroke and really simplify the number of hairs into the key essential hair clusters or hair forms. And the same is true for eyebrows, where I'll angle my brush so that it looks like very particular tufts of hair, and I try to darken the value where the eyebrow rolls around into darker lights, and sometimes, on certain setups, into shadow. And this has been How to Paint an Eye in Oil Paint. Thank you so much for watching. If you want to see more of my content, make sure you check me out at Patreon or on my website where you can find feature-length tutorials. Both those links are in the description down below. And if you want to help my channel grow, make sure you tell all your friends, tell everyone, tell people you don't even know, just go out and shout it at them politely. Just tell them about my channel and we can grow this together so I can keep making content like this, which I love doing and I hope you all find useful. Thanks for watching and I'll see you next time.